Hey, it's John from Enduring Charm. I'm in the middle of redoing parts of my shop for an upcoming project, and I thought I'd talk to you today about router tables. This is an old one that I built, 20 years ago or maybe more. And it's actually done the job. I'll get into some of the details of that in a minute. But I just built a second one, which is just gonna serve me for slightly different purposes. And I wanna go over how you can make one of these yourself for dirt cheap. If you look at online and catalogs and stuff for woodworking, there are router tables you can buy which are extremely expensive. They sell you the top, they sell you the base, all sorts of accessories and plates and guides and all sorts of things. And you can easily spend between $300 and $800 without even blinking. So I want to show you how you can make a really cheap but very functional router table just out of scrap stuff, maybe with a few odds and ends like the plate and the guide. But we're talking, you know, $100 in that range, or maybe even less if you work at it. All right, let's take a quick look at my old router table. Now this thing, like I said, was built 20 years ago and it had different purposes in mind back in the day. At that time I had a very small shop, so I had all sorts of built-in compartments for various things that I built, and it served the purpose, and it still does serve the purpose. Even though I'm not really using it the exact same way today, I still use it, and it's one of my primary tools in the shop. Now back in that period, the plate for the router would not come pre-drilled or even made at all. It's really just a phenolic product that you drilled and made your own plate out of. So that's what I did, and let me just lift this out. Oh boy, find a way to hold that. Okay, so this was an old Bosch router, which is still going strong. It's a 1611, and you mounted the router to the bottom of the plate there. This is 3/8 inch phenolic. And you made your own hole, and it was all done by hand. But it's worked out fine. And what I did, actually, while I have this open here, what I did to hold this plate down was to put just a little piece of metal under here, and I used some machine bolts with wing nuts. And so I put the machine bolt through the plate here, through the metal, and that holds everything down. Let me just temporarily put this back here. So this worked fine. To make this, I routed out the top here, which I'll talk more about in a second, and the runner for a miter gauge or whatever else I'm using, I didn't even use metal. I just routed out, or maybe I dadoed, I can't remember which, a slot here, and I used plywood to, make it the same width as a slot, and I made, here, I have it up here, actually. Still use the damn thing. I just made my own runner. Again, this is 20 years old, but it works great. There's no problems with it. And I can clamp onto this using just regular C-clamps, just about anything I want. So when I'm making doors and things like that, this is what I use, and it's worked out great. Back in the time, I did purchase this Incred jig to make the fence setup and everything. Honestly, I don't even use it. What I use for a fence these days, and back when I learned, was just a scrap wood tied together like that. I use C-clamps to clamp it down, and I clamp to the edge of the tabletop. And because it doesn't, in most cases, doesn't matter how the fence is oriented towards the bit, in other words, if it's crooked like this, it really doesn't matter for most operations, then it's fine. For operations that it does matter, I can use this slot here to align my fence, make these two parallel, and it goes pretty quickly, honestly. So that's what I've been using all these years. Now, notice that the orientation of this top, the short side is the cutting side. For the new top that I'm making, the long side is the cutting side. And that's one thing that I probably would have changed from the original, is to go this way, because it just gives you more room to stretch the material that you're cutting so that you're not, flopping back and forth there and making a bad cut. So I'm going to talk about this top in a second, and I'll take this all apart and deconstruct it for you. It's not completely done yet, but it's very cheap to make. The legs are 2x material. In fact, this is a single 2x4 to make all four legs. It's cut 1.5x1.5. I got a little door for access to the router, and the top isn't even attached yet. I have a little shelf area underneath just to hold a fence or spare things that I might want to keep under there. But it's very inexpensively made. maybe half a sheet of plywood is all I used. All right, with the top off, you can see how this is constructed. Extremely simple. I just use glue and staples. So I just use plywood. I cut out or notched this leg. You don't even have to do that. You could wrap the plywood around it. It really doesn't matter. It just needs to be strong, and the glue and staples will hold it. These corner blocks here keep it roughly square, and I have a hole here so I can drill up from underneath to attach the top, and I'll probably also use some silicone here just to make sure it's got a nice seat to it. You notice this thing's rocking in my shop a little bit because the floor is not perfectly even. So if you want, you can put adjusters on the bottom of the legs, or you can just shove a shim under there, whichever is easier for you. But it really is not that critical. I see a lot of router tables that are set up like, you know, for a machinist or something. I'm a woodworker, not a machinist. So I just don't need that kind of accuracy, honestly. And the expense involved, I'd rather spend on other things. So with that in mind, that's what the bottom looks like. Now let's talk about the top and making the top, which is really the source of concern for a lot of woodworkers. All right, the top can be daunting, I guess, if you haven't made one before, but it's really nothing to be too worried about. First of all, the material itself, you can get probably from different sources. Now, you're gonna laugh if you're in the computer industry and you happen to know this, but this top, it's roughly 24 by 32, and it comes from an old disk drive, a Hewlett-Packard 7906 disk drive. The disk drive was stored in kind of a cabinet, and this was the top of the cabinet. So this goes back to the 60s, or maybe 70s. So there's all sorts of sources for tops like this. If you look at school desks, for example, they often have a material very similar to this. You could even use MDF if you strengthen it. So there's all sorts of sources for top. But basically, you need something that's kind of slickery on the top and has enough thickness so that there's strength there. But this is going to be sitting on top of the stand, so, you know, that will give it some strength as well. Now, putting the plate in is an area of concern for a lot of folks. And some of the systems that you can buy have adjusters on the corners. You can actually buy those separately in some cases. And the plate itself is a source of some concern. So what I've done here for this one, this is an aluminum plate rather than the phenolic that I've used before. And it's very strong. This particular one is sold by Rockler, which Rockler makes or sells fairly decent stuff. I do sometimes have problems with their ordering systems, but by and large, they're a good company. And so I bought this from them. It is pre-drilled for the router that I'm gonna be using, but it's really not a big deal whether it's aluminum or plastic or phenolic or whatever you're using to drill the holes yourself. And then you are gonna wanna have some kind of hold downs on the side there just to keep this thing from rattling around. Now, how do you make this hole here to hold the plate? What you can see here is a reveal or a rabbet that I've made, and it's really not all that difficult. To do this, you're gonna use a router, as a matter of fact. You need to have the plate in advance, and what you're gonna do is make yourself a template like this one. The plate is the same size as the template. The template's actually a little bit bigger because once I make this template, I'm going to use this router with a collar on it. You see that little collar slipping down there? And that collar rides against the edge of this template. So you need to account for the space of that collar. So basically this template is, I don't know, a 16th or slightly more bigger on each side than the plate itself. But you can put the plate down on the piece of wood that you're using as a template and just mark it a 16th bigger or whatever it needs to be. The other method you could use would be to make the opposite template, which is take a piece of wood, size this slightly smaller than the plate itself, and again, use the collar to ride around the edge of this. That's not as accurate, I don't think, because you have a tendency to slip, especially on this kind of stuff, when you're doing the routing. So you can do it that way, and then basically you'd screw through this into the material itself temporarily to hold it in place while you're routing around it. But I think this method with the template surrounded on the outside is just a better way to go. So basically you're gonna mount this template, you're gonna clamp it in place on the edge there, you're gonna stick your router in there, use the collar to ride around the edge, and you will have set the depth of your cutting bit so that it's the same as this. Now that, again, causes some worry for people, because what if you screw up and you cut it too deep. It's really not that big a deal, honestly. If you're a little bit off, I mean, hopefully you can get it within a 16th or a little better, 32nd maybe, or perfect. But if you can't, you can always either get the leveling, the third-party leveling screws that they sell, or honestly, just a little bit of tape, like the aluminumized tape or metal tape that they use on ductwork, even duct tape itself. Just something to, you know, put in there to raise this up a little bit is all you're going to really need. But I don't really have a problem cutting this so that it's dead on perfect. And like I said, that other one that I've had for 20 years, it's been that way for 20 years, and I've never had a problem with that one either. So just take your time, make yourself a good template, try a test piece to make sure it's the right size, and then once you're happy with it, stick it on the material that you're using for the tabletop and route your slot there. Now, this slot, this isn't even attached yet, the slot I made for the miter gauge, I did buy this separately, and it was, I forget now, maybe between $20 and $30, I think. And it's aluminum, and it does have the, you know, that little extra bit in the slot there to hold the miter gauge from falling out if you have that style. If you want, you could just cut this slot with a dado blade or with a router and a straight edge, and just leave it like this and make like I did in two decades ago with a plywood-based miter gauge. Or you can buy a slot like this, you'll route or dado this groove to accept this, stick it in there, and then I just gotta drill some screw slots and this will screw in place, and then you'll be done. So the tabletop is really not that difficult. It's one of those things where you just have to take your time and make sure you're double checking yourself on a piece of scrap before you actually make the commitment, but it's really not that hard. The distance between here and here is not, you know, super critical, but depending on what you're doing, you might want to think that through just to make sure you're not making it too close or too far away, depending on what you're trying to do with your table. Now, because I have two tables, the distance between here on this one is a little greater than my other one because I want to give myself more flexibility to do things. But once the top is made, that's really the hard part. And then the base, honestly, can be made out of plywood like I did or just about anything you want. So that's how you can make a dirt cheap router table. In this case, the materials for the plate and little bits of hardware that I bought were under $100. And honestly, I think is around $50 or $60. So if you just want to buy the plate, that's all you really, really need. And then you can add things later as you need. Because I'm leaving, let me show you on this one. Because I leave a little space here, it allows me to clamp down a homemade fence that I make. You can even make, I did this 20 years ago, you can even make your own clamps like this so that you can, you know, screw that in and clamp it in place, or you can just use the C-clamps, which honestly is quicker, and that's what I've been using in recent years. I should also mention, if you need dust collection, you can buy these plastic little doodads here, and basically you're gonna drill a 3 or 4 inch hole on the side here, screw that in place, and that'll give you access for your dust collection. And similarly, if you want to do like a plug and a switch like I did years ago, you know, you could do that after the fact. That's something you could decide later. You could also mount this on a leg or something like that. I haven't determined what I'm going to do on this particular one yet. But all right, router table's all done except for the dust port, which I ordered and it just isn't here yet. But I'll end up cutting a hole here and, you know, attaching that dust port that I showed you earlier. But otherwise, we're all set. We got this miter gauge slot installed and it's just screwed into place. I got my hold downs on the plate to keep that solid, and I'll be mounting a router in here next. I do have to drill a little hole right around here to allow access to the router upper and lower. I don't know what the term is. There's a little router riser built into this router, and I need to make a little hole for access for that. Otherwise, this is ready to go. And I have electric installed, so again, I just put a switch here, and this is an extension cord. There will be, here's a little catch for my door, there will be a little hole I'll drill somewhere in the middle here to allow the cord from the router to come down and then come back up and attach here. I like having electric close by where the switch is close and I can even yank the plug out if I need to, if something goes ugly. So that's what it looks like. I just would encourage you, if you're looking at router tables or thinking about making your own, to think realistically about these things. There's an awful lot of overpriced stuff out there. I'm sure it's very good, but I just don't think it's necessary. And I mean, I'm a pro and I'm making, you know, serious cabinets on these things, and I find, you know, something like this to be perfectly adequate for what I'm doing. You have all sorts of homemade fences you can make to make this more flexible depending on what you're doing. And I just think a homemade or do-it-yourself kind of router table like this is all you really need.